transport. So we know how to deal with vectors when they're moving from one location to another across the space-time, across the manifold. And we also gave a physical association to the meaning of the geodesic curves through the Lagrangian through a least action approach, in which we have seen that those are the trajectories of free particles. So if you have a free particle, they are going to follow Lagrangian. And that's true for matter particles, or particles with a mass, or massless particles, such as photons, for example. And this gives you an automatic way, and a very natural way, actually, to explain gravitational lensing. Because also with the Newtonian approach, you can get a result out of it, and you can, just because between the force term and the acceleration term of the other side, you have the same mass, which cancel. So you can assume that photons have a mass, and therefore you can derive an equation that describes gravitational lensing through Newtonian mechanics around the suns. But you see that is not kind of consistent, because you assume that gravity, in a Newtonian picture, is sourced by matter. And if you set and for photons, they don't have any matter, and therefore they shouldn't interact with mass through this force in terms of Newtonian physics, in Newtonian gravity. But in GR, the relationship is natural. They are just going straight, according to themselves, okay? In the sense that they are following this generalization of straight lines, which are the geodesics. So they just follow the geodesics. So this is a very natural way to explain gravitational lensing. Then we've also seen how to relate, use again this, the geodesic equation, now not for a vector, but for a one form. You see that it takes a different shape with respect to the one associated to vectors, in which it's clear that if you have a direction along which the metric is not changing, you can define a conserved quantity, right? We had an equation of this sort, in which we basically had the, for example, some one form over the tau was equal to, there was a one half, then we have the mass, if I'm using, and then we have the momentum, then we have u alpha, u beta, d nu, g alpha, beta. Okay? Now I gave you a different expression in which there was the momentum here, but you know, I'm divided by m2, which gives us an m here. There was an m here. Okay? So that's exactly the very same equation that I gave you the last time. If we want to go back in time, we can also write it like this. Okay? That's exactly the very same thing. It's perhaps nicer in this form, because on this side you have a momentum, which is the things that might be conserved, and on this side you just have the velocities that goes along. So these vectors define the direction along which the particle is going, right? So if you wish, it's a bit cleaner. Now, you see that if this guy is equal to zero, then this is conserved. It's not going to evolve as a function of the proper time. Okay, it's conserved, it's not changing, it's always the same. Then we got a question in which, what about, I can also have this situation in which this is equal to zero. And that's true. And in fact, you might have, for example, defined a bad coordinate system in which there are, if you get a different portion of the, let's say, for example, I gave you also the example, so I don't know why it didn't come up to my mind, but I gave you the example of central mass. And if we are using Cartesian coordinates, and if we have a particle moving along geodesics, the geodesics might be something like that, close to an ellipse. We know that it's precessing, but it's close to an ellipse, right? So if we are looking for some conserved quantity, and we're using Cartesian coordinates, this guy is going to be always different than zero. Okay, the derivative of the matter is different than zero, but the combination with uv can be equal to zero. Why? Because let's take a spherical system, which makes it life easier, okay? Then you know that if you have a particle is moving around a circle, it's very good, it's very convenient not to use Cartesian, but to use spherical coordinates. And we see that in this system, It's not the angular, it's not the momentum which is conserved in terms of momentum in this direction and momentum in this direction. These are the two components of the momentum, but it's the angular momentum which is conserved. Okay? Then if you change your coordinate system, you can still see that this quantity, now in spherical coordinates, not in Cartesian coordinates, which becomes the angular momentum, is actually conserved and is still associated to a symmetry in your system. Okay? Let's make it even more trivial. Let's say that we have a free particle that is moving in this direction, straight. Okay? And then we can change our coordinate system in this way. Okay? And then there is gravity, the space is curved, and it's following some other trajectory. You see that now the momentum is shifting from one component to another. So the individual momentums are not conserved. The momentum in general is not conserved, but you can define a coordinate system along which you can identify symmetries if there are symmetries in your system. Okay? So it boils down to, if we have a if the metric is not changing along the x nu direction, this is equal to zero, this guy is conserved. But then you have also a more general situation in which this guy, that looks a bit more complex, can be equal to zero. Okay? And that's related to Killing vectors. In which we can look not for the momentum as they are for the whatever coordinate systems we have, but we are looking for projection of the momentums in some other, along some other vector, which is called Killing vector. Okay? It is also associated, this concept is also associated to the Lie derivatives. For which you have an exercise, in which there are, I mean, the concept is very simple. These are just whenever you define a Lie derivative of a vector field, and then you take a whatever tensor. Let's take, for example, the metric G mu nu, and this is equal to zero. Then this gives you, this guy is the Killing vector field. Okay, it's all the same concept. It all boils down to the very same concept that you can see up there. Okay? So Lie derivatives are just associated to some direction. So if the metric is not changing along that direction, it's constant, and this vector field defining the direction along which we are looking the change of the derivative is the Killing vector field. Okay? So you see, it's the same concept, just written in different ways. Okay? Then if you do the exercise, there should be the elements to go through it. If there are issues there, just speak with the tutors, or we will see how the tutorials are going to be, and then in case I can go back to the Lie derivatives to give you a little bit a broader overview perhaps. But this is the concept. Okay? Is this clear? Okay, good. Now, we shall continue, and now what we want to do is to investigate the properties of spacetime, because the elements, the objects, the mathematical objects that we have so far are not completely sufficient. Because the geodesic equation quantifies, if you want, a trajectory. In which you have a particle and you can think about it as the particle moving somewhere. Okay? But you can also think it the way around. We can stick, so this guy is moving across coordinates. Okay? But you can also think like I am in the particle and the coordinates are flowing through me. Okay? You see that this has nothing to do with gravity. It is just a way of dealing with coordinate systems that can be arbitrary as you want. And that's not an intrinsic property of the spacetime. And this is clear by the fact that you can change your coordinate system. We did it for the bottle, in which we had our falling bottle. And if we have an acceleration, which is the one of g, of gravity, inside the bottle we have a Minkowski metric. You see? This telling I'm changing coordinate system, gravity is gone. There is not there anymore. So the geodesic equation, you see, is just related to change of coordinate system, to deal with change, arbitrary coordinate systems. Then we have seen a bit more complicated object, which is the connection. But also this guy is not sufficient to give you a full representation and description of the intrinsic curvature of the spacetime. Because again, you can change your system in which, using the same trick, in which you have that the metric g mu nu is equal to nu mu nu. And look that it's equal is not an approximation because I'm not considering an area, okay, over which the metric can be changing, but is that point is the Minkowski metric, okay? Then you move a bit, there are tidal forces, so you need to get, you know, the higher terms, but at first order, in that point, is the Minkowski metric, and if you are in torsion free, the affine connection vanishes. So it looks fully like flat spacetime. It doesn't tell you anything. To understand and get an understanding of the curvature of spacetime, you need a non-local quantity. So to grasp curvature, which is an intrinsic property of spacetime, not of the coordinate system, we need a non-local measure. The understanding of this is very intuitive because in this case we took a point, this one here. We need to move around because if we have the Earth, for instance, and we are here, we have a massive particle here which is moving this direction with some acceleration. Let's call it point one and acceleration one. I take another particle, which is a bit further away, then the acceleration is going to be smaller. Particle two, G2. And you see that now there is, if I take two different positions, I see that there is a relative acceleration between the two. This is something that tells you, guy, there is gravity. There is a tidal field acting in this region of space, and this is going to tell us that there is a gravitational field. Okay? Different acceleration, gravity. Okay? So you understand that we need something that is related. It is related to derivatives of the metric. That is something related to the derivatives of the connection. You need to see the change, how things are changing from one location to another, something non-local. And furthermore, what we want something that is tensorial. We want tensor quantities. Because tensors, if you have a tensor, let's call it whatever, A, mu nu, and this guy is different than zero in one rest frame, then it is different than zero for every coordinate system. I said rest frame, forget coordinate system, okay? So if this guy is different than zero in some frame, in some coordinate system, then it's different than zero everywhere. You cannot put it to zero. You cannot play this trick to get this guy and make it disappear in some restring. Because we are looking for a tensor, and tensors are not, if they are different than zero in one frame, they are always different than zero. And if they are equal to zero in one frame, they are always equal to zero. Okay? So that's what we are looking for. The two quantities, one of which we already met, that could be used to characterize the intrinsic properties of spacetime, are torsion and curvature. The first one we already seen, and in GR, we have seen that we set torsion T equal to zero. Okay? It's an assumption. It's not coming from first principle or whatever. It's an assumption. But before I give away this term, I would like to investigate it a little bit more, because otherwise you get some misconcept about the curvature. Because in the end, in a torsion free, the curvature is going to tell you about the commutation of double covariant derivatives, as we are going to see. Okay? But the non-commutation of double covariant derivatives is not only given by curvature, it's also given by torsion. Okay, many times this is missed. So I will let it survive for a while, and then we will set it to zero for good, and we will be in full GR. Now pay a lot of attention to these terms, a curvature, because then we are going to define other tensors that are going to lead us to the Einstein tensor. That contains the curvature that usually is labeled with R. Okay? Because this guy is the core of the Einstein's fields equation. This guy is the core, is the key geometrical object that characterizes general relativity, that characterizes gravity. Okay? And now I'm talking about physics, okay? I'm talking about gravity, not about some weird coordinate systems that gave us a lot of information, because we also used the variational approach to get a physical interpretation of that object, but still, in principle, I mean, itself, the geodesic equation deals only with generic coordinate systems. Through these tensors, we will have the instruments to fully derive the Einstein's fields equation. And they look very simple, because you're going to have the Einstein tensor on one side, you are going to have some constant, and then you're going to have a term which is associated to matter, actually energy, matter and energy, because this is going to be the energy momentum tensor that is the source of the curvature of space-time. So matter and the energy momentum tensor in general is going to perturb the space-time and make it curved. Okay? And the way around, the curvature of space-time is going to affect the movement of matter. Okay? You see, this is a nonlinear equation because of this very concept. There is this feedback between this back reaction between matter and between matter and the curvature of space-time, so they're affecting one each other, and it's quite complicated to solve. Okay? It can be done analytical with some specific cases that we are going to meet. Okay? But in general, they are extremely complicated. Good, so you see, a little cute, tiny equation, but it's actually quite complex to solve. So now, you don't need to understand all of that, I just want to tell you what is the path. Okay, and then we are going step by step through all of that. So torsion first to understand this guy and then get rid of it. curvature. Then there is a series of other elements that are used to build up the Einstein tensor, which is the key of Einstein's fields equation. Okay, so that's what we are going to do. Good. So let's see then torsion, what it really is. Well, torsion is a bilinear mapping, which is usually labeled with T, that is wallowing two vector fields to return a vector field. So I showed you a way of labeling the tangent space, which was like TP, or you could have also written as MPT. Okay, so that's the tangent space at position P. Without the P, we are dealing with a vector field. Okay, so it's a field, it's a vectorial field that is defined in all positions over the manifold. Okay. Good. And it is defined as T, it's swallowing two vectors, V and W, and it is defined as the commutator of covariant derivatives. Not double covariant derivatives, but covariant derivatives. So we have the directional derivative with respect to V of the other vector minus the directional derivative with respect to W of the first vector. Plus, there is an additional term, well, actually minus, there is an additional term, which is the commutator of V and W, the two input parameters. Okay? Now, what's the meaning of this guy? So you see here we have something that looks like, so it's the directional derivative of W. You can think of it in terms of parallel transport. And you can think of this guy as you have two vectors, let's say W, and let's say you have another vector, let's make it like this. You have another vector V. Then you compute the directional derivative of W with respect to V, and it's kind of shifting this guy, paralleling, transporting in this direction, and you get something like that, perhaps. Then you have this guy, you parallel transport it along this vector, and we know that in a curved spacetime, there can be changes. So you parallel transport it, and you get perhaps something like that. Okay, so you see that you are getting a vector field after you apply torsion, which is actually this operation, and torsion gives you the difference between the ending point, if you wish. Gives you the difference, it tells you how parallelograms do not close. You could have this situation, so the parallelogram crossed, and torsion gives you the information about the fact that they might not close. Okay? So it tells you commutation about the commutation of covariance derivatives. And it tells you about the fact that if parallelograms cross or not. Close or not, and if they don't close, it tells you by how much. So this is torsion. And you see, it's not a tensor. It's not a tensor because you know that tensors goes from swallows whatever vector spaces vectors, one forms or whatever, and gives you a real number. That's not the case. Therefore, you see that actually we were not dealing with torsion in itself. Usually people just say torsion for brevity, but actually we were dealing with a torsion tensor. Which is something slightly different. You see, we want something that gives you a real number. The output of the guy up there is a vector. Therefore, to get a real number out of a vector, we need to apply a what? One form, right? Such that there is this sort of scalar product acting that gives you a one form. That gives you a real number. Therefore, we have what we had before, which is that, plus we need to apply a one form to it. This gives you a real number. Therefore, this guy is something that is swallowing a one form, a vector, then what they used, u, another vector, and gives you something that looks like that. So the one form that we are applying to, and then the guy up there, which is actually t, and then v, and u. Where we have these two guys that belong to a vector space, and this guy that belongs to the dual of a vector space, the vector space of one forms. Now, what are the components? Well, you know that to have the components, you need to get your object. And instead of giving some arbitrary object, you make it swallow the basis that you have chosen. And now, to make things clear and have it associated to coordinates to Cartesian frame as we did in the previous derivations, your basis sets are going to be the one for the vectors and the one for the one forms. Okay, this is for one forms and that's for vectors. And I'm using the prototypical basis, which is associated to gradients and which is associated to shifts, as we have seen in the past lectures. Okay? Good. So now the components are going to be, we just get our construction that we have up there. So the component T, and I use K, I, J, are going to be equal to, first we need to swallow a one form, this guy here. So we have the X tilde E. Then we have our torsion object to which we are applying our two vectors, in this case the basis E and the basis J. Now that we have that, we just need to apply the definition that we have on top. So we have the XE. Now let's take a component of this guy, and I use the indices as wrong, K and E, of course. Okay, better. Okay, of course, one is for one form, the other one is for vector. The indices are to be flipped. Okay, good. So we take K, and for dummy variable, we can use gamma. So this is the kth basis gamma component. And now it's applied to the tensor, to the torsion that we have up there. So is the covariant derivative of the first vector, the E applied to the second vector, the J component gamma minus the J, and then we have J and then the gamma and the E. Then, in principle, we have also the commutation of the two objects, the E and the, so that's gamma, J, but this is identically zero, because the two vectors commute. Okay, so it disappears. We don't see it anymore. I just remind you, I've seen some kind of pseudo-lost faces. The commutator AB is defined as AB minus BA. That's it, okay? So if you see this expression with the comma in the middle, that's the commutator of whatever it's swallowing. They can be tensors, can be vectors, can be scalars, whatever. It's defined in this way. You make the multiplication according to the multiplication rule that describes the link between the two elements, minus the same but flipped. That's the commutator, okay? Good, so this guy is equal to zero and basically goes away from our business. Then what we can do is to express the covariant derivatives explicitly. So this guy, we leave it here. And then we have the covariant derivative of this guy. So we have the E, the gamma J, plus, then we have E gamma. Then we have the dummy variable alpha. And then we have the object we were applying it to, which is this one. Then we have minus the same, but with flipped indices. So delta E gamma plus gamma, which is a dummy. Then we have J alpha. And then we have delta alpha and E. Now, these two guys commute. So you can flip you can flip one and the other. We have a minus in between, and this guy drops. Ha! Now you can see torsion, because as we know it, now we can let this guy act together with this one that give us a Kronecker delta. And in the end, was it a K? Kij is equal to T Kij minus the connection Kje. That we know. The difference with respect to what we had before is when we started, I told you, okay, we just call these objects, so the commutation of the connection, torsion. So I gave it to you as a definition. Now we went deeper into the understanding of these objects. We have its definition, which is given up there, which is namely the commutation of covariant derivatives that explains you how parallelograms close or not. And then we used it to create a tensor, which is the torsion tensor, and is exactly the very same object to which we applied a one form to obtain a real number, because tensors, whatever they are swallowing, they are giving you a real number. Then we just use the definition that is written up there, and we end up by identifying the coefficients of the tensor once it is applied to the basis system that we have chosen. To the set of bases that we have chosen, and give us this expression, okay? Now, you understand what this object is. But now you can say, it's weird, because these guys are not tensors. Kij is not a tensor. You're making the difference between two objects that are not tensors. Why do you get a tensor? Well, because if you remember the when we checked if this guy was a tensor or not, what we did? We look if it transforms as a tensor, right? So we just look for the transformation that lead us from K, from the connection Kij to another coordinate frame, to another basis set with the prime. And you remember that there was a term that had a tensorial shape, a tensorial transformation. So with this alone, it would have been a tensor, but it's not a tensor because there was an additional term. If you go back to the lecture notes, you will see that. Now, if you use this, if you compute now the transformation for Tk ij and you go to Tk prime I prime j prime, you need to apply this transformation. But now what you have? You have two terms that sum up together and gives you a tensorial form from one object and from the other object. Plus, you have these two terms in which you can commute terms that they cancel. They cancel each other. And this gives you a tensor. I gave you all the steps in the lecture notes. I'm not going to give it to you because it's something trivial. But here you understand why this guy is a tensor, because it does transform as a tensor. It's composed by these two objects, which transformation reveals their non-tensorial nature, because they have a term that shouldn't be there if this would have been a tensor. But whenever you make the difference between these two sort of objects, this guy, the contribution of this guy cancels, and you get only a purely tensorial transformation. So yes, the torsion tensor is a tensor. Okay? That's the idea. That's the very simple idea. Then the steps are really simple. Good. Let's now continue with curvature. Actually, we can have a break now. We can resume at 10 past 10, and then we continue with curvature so that we have everything on the board. Now, before you stand up, a very tiny little summary of what we covered. So I just gave you a better link between what we have seen for, between different ways of seeing at conserved quantities by looking simply at the geodesic equation written in that form. We saw that if we, from the start, had the right choice of coordinate frame, we can identify conserved quantities if the metric is not changing along the x nu direction, then the p nu component of the energy momentum of a particle is conserved. Then we have seen that we might have some bad choice of coordinate system, and therefore what one could investigate is the projection of the momentum over some vector. So if you have your momentum, you project it on some vector, and if this projection is invariant, so if the derivative of this projection is not changing with respect to tau, is an invariant quantity. So this allows you, these killing vectors, so these special vectors along which you made the projection of the momentum, allows you to derive conserved quantities. And then a slightly more sophisticated instrument are the Lie derivatives, which are related to directional derivative with respect to some vector field of the metric. So if this guy is equal to zero, you can identify the vector field that is associated to the symmetries in your system. And this vector field is, again, the killing vector that you see, that we derived in this simple way, and you understand why it's associated to the geodesic equation in that way. Good. Then we started a new discussion. We are starting to get a clean understanding, a quantification of the curvature of spacetime. And we have seen that the metric alone is not enough. The connection alone is not enough because there are quantities related in one point. And to investigate gravity, we need something that is non-local because, for instance, we need to investigate the acceleration between different points, right? If you have, where is going the Earth? Here. So if we have the Earth and we see two different locations, they are going to be accelerated in different ways. So that's a non-local measure, two different locations. And the difference in acceleration reveals the presence of gravity, reveals the presence of the curvature of space-time. Then we, having this understanding that we need to something that is non-local, these guys, we understand it must be related to this sort of thing. And we understand that it must be of tensorial nature because we cannot make it vanish. If it is an intrinsic property of our curvature, if we change, we can change the coordinate system as we want, is the curvature of space-time, and this guy cannot change. Okay? Then we started to investigate then torsion. We gave a formal definition of this object, which is related to the commutation of covariant derivatives applied to vectors. And there is also a term that is associated to commutation of vector, but in this context vanishes, as we see here. We computed the components by applying the torsion to one form and construct a new object, which is the tensor, the torsion tensor. We computed the derivatives by applying it to the basis set that we have chosen, Cartesian frame in this case. And we arrived at something that we knew already from the start. But now it's not anymore just a definition, as I gave it to you at the beginning, but it has a motivation and it has a meaning. Then, finally, I showed you the way, the path, to prove that this guy is indeed a tensor because it does transform as a tensor. Later, we will continue along the path that I traced up there. We have done with torsion. We are going to see curvature. Okay? Good. So we can resume, now at 15 past 10.